Well, thank you, choir. That was a real blessing, and truly our Redeemer lives, and we'll be celebrating the resurrection of Jesus Christ next Sunday as we come together and celebrate our Savior's coming forth from the tomb. If you need a Bible this morning, these fine gentlemen would be pleased to place one in your hand here this morning, and I encourage you to use it as we'll be in the Gospels primarily here this morning. I want to mention for you this morning something to be in prayer about, if I may. On Monday night, we had a terrific time here with the men as I had the opportunity to share about a teaching opportunity in Asia that's coming up for me this summer. I got a report from Dr. Tuttle earlier this week, and he asked me to be in prayer because they were very concerned that some of the information that they'd been using, they were using a particular application on their phone, and they were concerned that it was not encrypted as they originally thought it was. Yesterday, I received a phone call from Dr. Tuttle saying that one of the key people over there, who's very key in a number of roles, and I'm, for sake of time, I won't elaborate, has been arrested and imprisoned. And this has huge ramifications because we're not sure about how much they know and what the future is going to look like. So there's a lot of things that are completely up in the air. This person had much to do with the location that I was heading to. And so it's very likely. Dr. Tuttle was very happy that I hadn't pushed buy on Expedia yet for my tickets because we're not sure it's going to happen there at that time. So it may be that I'll be over there teaching later on in the summer as there's another opening for the particular course that I've been preparing for. So the Lord knows all these things, but what I want to do this morning is just really go before the Lord in prayer and ask God to really encourage the brethren over there. There are scripture references that talk about praying for those who are being persecuted. So it's not Persecuted Church Sunday, but let's just all stand, shall we? Heavenly Father, we come before you this morning, mindful, Lord, that you know all things, that, Lord, your hand is sovereign. And Lord, you know the beginning from the end. Lord, we're concerned with what's happening. We're concerned with our brothers in Christ, and Father, I'm also concerned with the future and how much exposure has actually taken place. Father, I lift up the persecutors this morning, and I pray for their salvations, knowing that the Holy Spirit of God does a mighty work in the hearts of men everywhere. And perhaps, Father, some even right now will be encouraged to put their faith in Jesus Christ. And Father, I lift up this gentleman who's been imprisoned because of his work on behalf of the gospel. Lord, he's not a pastor. He's not a missionary. He's a Christian businessman. And I lift him up before you, and I lift up his family. And I pray, Father, that you would be with him during this time. What has become very normative there for the believers is something quite foreign to us. But Father, we lift them up and we pray for your strength and mercy to be upon them all. And the work that is yet future to be done, how we pray your blessing would be upon it. As you open doors and close doors, may we be faithful to follow you always. In Jesus' name, amen. You may be seated. Well, take your Bibles, please, and turn to the book of Matthew, chapter 13. Matthew, chapter 13. It was nice because I was sitting up front when Steve Nemeth mentioned that I'll be speaking on hell today, and I didn't see how many people left the auditorium because of that. It's not the most, you know, it's not the most popular subject. It's, in fact, something that we very rarely hear taught or certainly preached on. And yet I know that the doctrine involving eternal torment or hell is one of the reasons that I came and placed my faith in Jesus Christ. Peter writes and he says, some will come and embrace the love of Christ and that will be their motivation. Others, because of fear, will place their faith in Jesus Christ. And I remember as a young person hearing about hell and the reality of hell and thinking to myself, that's not a place I want to spend one moment in. And so I put my faith in Jesus Christ and I was saved from the consequence of my sin, which is hell. There are 160 some odd places in the Bible in the New Testament that talk about hell. And do you realize that out of that 162 references to hell or Gehenna, Hades, Sheol, etc., eternal torment, 70 of those teachings came from the lips of Jesus himself. So one thing that we're absolutely clear on is the fact that Jesus did not shy away from the subject whatsoever. But he took the subject head on, and he approached it because it was worthy of the people knowing and understanding the significance of. You and I stand on the cusp of a great Sunday. Are you excited about coming to church next Sunday? Yeah, you say, oh, yeah, and I'll be happy when you're done preaching on hell. And next Sunday when we come, it's so exciting, isn't it? I mean, we're here for Friday night, and we're dealing with the significance of the crucifixion, and our Jesus has been laid in the tomb, and Sunday morning we come in like dancing. I mean, we're excited because the resurrection has taken place, and we kind of relive it in our minds. It's awesome. It's fantastic. Well, it used to be people generally went to church in our country, and as time has gone on, that's fallen away, and now most of the time people go to church, if they go to church, on Christmas or right. And so we have an opportunity this week to invite people to come and to hear the significance of the gospel. And, you know, some churches will say, you know, invite your friends. We want to have your friends come to church because we want to grow our church. And I would submit to you that that's not at all what this is about. What it should be about is that we're concerned for the souls of men and women, and we want them to hear the good news of Jesus Christ. Are you thinking about inviting anyone to church this next Sunday? Here's a little skit. It's kind of funny, and it kind of depicts the whole thing. Oh, is it by mom? Is it by me? It's our neighbor, Kevin.
Hey, neighbor! Can you see me? That is a very high-tech normal you got there. Very 2001.
Space Odyssey, not the year.
I'm so sorry. It's our neighbor.
Hey, I brought back all your stuff I ever borrowed from you. All of it.
Yeah, you know what? You just stay right there.
I'll show it to you, all right? Remember this?
That was fun, wasn't it? Thanks for that.
I know I borrowed this to make them muffins, but it is fantastic at sifting through the cat litter. I'll get you a new one. Hey, is this your house key?
You know what? I'll just let myself in.
Stop!
Hey, sermon's up there, mister. I'm trying to learn about my Savior's birth.
Resurrection.
Whatever.
Hey, you go to church? Why didn't you just invite me?
Daddy, why didn't you invite Kevin to church?
Oh, please, like you invited your neighbors to church. Hey, welcome.
Glad y'all are here.
Happy Easter.
It's really not that difficult.
Can I keep your nunchucks?
Well, this morning I want to give you a reason to invite someone to church next Sunday. And the reason has everything to do with their eternal destination. If you take your Bibles, go with me to Matthew chapter 13. Matthew chapter 13. We know that Jesus spoke quite a bit on the subject of what happens after our life ends on this planet. What will be the reality that faces us? And certainly we know that there is much to consider. Matthew chapter 23 says, how can you escape the damnation of hell? That's what Jesus said. You know, one writer put it this way. He said, there is no way to describe hell. Nothing on earth compares to it. No living person has any real idea of it. No madman in wildest flights of insanity ever beheld its terror. No man in delirium ever pictured a place so utterly terrible as this. No nightmare racing across a fevered mind ever produced a terror to match that of the mildest hell. Let the most cited writer exhaust his skill in describing this roaring cavern of unending flame, and he would not even brush in fancy the nearest edge of hell. Jesus talks about the judgment here in Matthew chapter 13. And he begins it there in verse 47 when he begins to give an illustration or a parable of sorts here of the dragnet. The kingdom of heaven, Jesus said, and remember here, this is written to a Jewish audience, is like a dragnet cast into the sea and gathering fish of every kind. And it was filled, they drew it up on the beach, and they sat down and they gathered the good fish into containers, but the bad they threw away. How many of you here today are fishermen? Fisherwomen, fishermen, fish. You like to fish. How many like to fish? Well, that explains it. I'm telling you what, the percentage was off the charts the first service. Those people like to get up earlier because they like to fish. The rest of y'all like to sleep in, and by the time you get up, the fishing's all over. Well, there's different methodologies that people use for fishing. And I'm going to use the clicker and maybe get a response, or maybe not. The first way that we can fish is with a fishing pole. We fish with a fishing pole using fishing line and fishing reels, and sometimes we stand on the shoreline, and sometimes we use boats. And the next picture that pops up there hopefully will be a boat. Better late than never. This little harbor up in Massachusetts, I had a boat there in 1978, and we fished with a fishing pole. It's one way that you can fish. But it's always difficult because oftentimes the fish aren't biting. You should have been here yesterday. Exactly. Well, if you don't like to fish because the fish don't bite, you could use a casting net. Casting nets are very effective. When Jesus talked to Andrew and to Peter, he told them that they would become fishers of men. And this is the word that he uses, and this is the type of fishing that he described for them. You could take this net, and even though the fish were finicky that day, you could cast it upon them. And there's weights along the edges of the net. They sink down, you draw it in, and voila, you have a catch. This takes a lot of skill. It's not an easy thing to do at all. Another way to fish is with a fish weir. Maybe you've heard of the Cherokee Indians who use fish weirs in creeks. This was a fish weir that is up near where I grew up. In fact, some of my ancestors used to use fishing weirs out on Cape Cod Bay, and they would actually utilize this way as an effective way to fish. The fish would come in, swim into the net from either side, and they would follow the net. Some followed the net out into open water, but others followed the net into an encircled area where they would go. And some of my relatives would put those fish weirs out on the shelf, and when the tide went out, it left a sandy bottom, and they'd go out there as the tide was going down and gather those fish in. They put them in barrels on the back of wagons. They would take them off to the train station, and they would be shipped up to Boston where they would sell them. Well, these are methods of fishing. Well, there's another one, and this is the one Jesus talks about. This is a dragnet. It's got flotation on top. It has weights on the bottom. And you can see from that demonstration. Oftentimes, what they would do is they would take one end of this net, and they would put it anchored to shore. The boat would go out, and sometimes a half a mile long, depending on how big the nets were, and they would take that out to the open water, and they would begin to make a large circle. They would circle back with the boat and bring the net then around in this big circle and draw it up onto the beach. Here's a big ship that has one of these big drag nets. The word in the original is the word we get the word seine nets from. And I used to use a seine net as a little kid. I used to go about catching minnows right up along the edge of the shore. And that was always a lot of fun to do. Well, you can do that, and it's not that difficult to do it. Jesus says that the kingdom of heaven is like a fishing net. And it's fascinating if you look at the teaching points at what Jesus was trying to say here, because as we pull this apart and we think about one of these drag nets, we think about a net that is absolutely immense. It's huge. and it's able to include everything. If you're on the bottom, it's going to get you. If you're within its grasp, you're going to be gathered up and pulled up to shore. Several years ago, there was a fisherman on the back of one of the boats out in Cape Cod Bay, and they were actually dragging. We call them draggers. And he had the nets out there, and he had evidently some medical issue, and he fell into the water, and he drowned or was dead when he hit the water. They looked for his body for quite some time, but it was a cold winter month, and they never did find his body. Until later on in the spring, there was another dragger out there, and they had pulled all the nets in, and lo and behold, but there's our good friend. And no, he wasn't alive anymore, no. And when you think about it, this net is really pretty fascinating. You pull that net in, you don't know what you're going to get. You can get sharks. You can get swordfish. You could get tuna fish. Yahoo. You could get something that's really good to eat. You're going to get codfish. You're going to get haddock. You might get sardines. You could get all kinds of things by pulling that dragnet in. And when it all came into the boat, or in this case, when Jesus was teaching, if it all came into the shore, it needed to be sorted out. And the fishermen would sort through the fish that came in to the shore. They would come in and they would analyze the catch. And some of it's a bycatch. That's what they term the fish that are inedible. And they're not going to eat those. They're unintended fish. They bring them all in. Jesus is teaching a principle here, and his principle should never be missed. Slowly but surely, God is moving through the seas of time, and he's bringing all men to a point of accountability. Fish, like men, would not readily accept this reality. If a fish was swimming along, he's just out there minding his business, and he brushed up against something, he would think, oh, what is that? And he would swim away. And after he swam into the water, he would get away from the net, and he would think to himself, okay, all right, life is back to normal. And he would swim around a little bit longer, but as the net began to be drawn in and the water was getting less and less available for that fish, he might bump into that net again, and he thinks to himself, what in the world is this? And he swims away again. Men are like that as well. We think to ourselves, there's nothing to worry about. There's nothing that I need to concern myself with. We develop a philosophy of life that doesn't include any reality of judgment. And we hope that that is real. But as men are swimming through life, so the fish in the net are swimming through life. And eventually they're pulled in, and they find themselves in a situation that's not good. The process in all of this, and the application that God gives, is the separation of the fish when they're on shore. Notice with me here in this passage, as Jesus is taught, they're going to be gathered up, these good fish and the bad fish, into containers. The bad fish are thrown away, the good fish are drawn in and saved. Verse 49 says, so it will be at the end of the age, the angels will come forth and take out the wicked from among the righteous, and will throw them into the furnace of fire. In that place there will be weeping and gnashing of teeth. You see, there is coming a time when the separation or the judgment will take place. This is Jesus' main point in teaching this parable. He wanted them to concern themselves with the reality of an impending judgment. And judgment is not a topic today that is particularly popular. And in a little bit, I'll explain to you why that most likely is. But nonetheless, it's real. In Matthew 25, Jesus is teaching, when the Son of Man comes in his glory and all the angels with him, he will sit on his glorious throne, and all the nations will be gathered before him, and he'll separate them from one another as the shepherd separates the sheep from the goats. And he'll put the sheep on his right hand and the goats on his left. That is a day of judgment. Now, we here who have placed our faith in Jesus Christ look forward to the next great event, which is the rapture of the church. Amen? We're caught away. The Bible says we're seized and we're taken to be with the Lord. The Bible describes that great event, and I look forward to it with great enthusiasm. After that rapture takes place and the church is no longer here on the earth, there will be 7 years of tribulation, such as the world, the Bible says, has never seen. This tribulation will be very great in its scope. It's a horrible reality. At the end of that seven-year period of time, my friends, Jesus Christ is coming back. We know that to be the second coming of Christ. Jesus promised the Jewish people that there would be that second coming. He has mentioned it numerous times. When he comes, he'll come far differently than he came the first time. In fact, the Bible describes the second coming as Jesus comes with his angels, the heavenly hosts. And the Bible says that the saints will be with him. You and I, as followers of Jesus Christ, will accompany Jesus as he comes there at the second coming. And there will come a time when those who are following him at the end of that tribulation will then go into the next period of time, which is the millennial kingdom, 1,000 years, where Christ sets up his ruling and reigning on the earth, and will be with him here during that 1,000-year reign. Now, if you flip in your Bible over to Matthew chapter 24, you see that this is mentioned. We know from the rapture of the church that we want to be caught up together with him in the clouds. And so all those who are people of faith in Jesus Christ will indeed experience that. But in the parable of the fig tree in Matthew chapter 24, 32, Jesus begins to discuss some of the future aspects. He talks about heaven and earth passing away, but my words will not pass away. Of that day, no one knows the day or the hour. The coming of the Son of Man will be just like the days of Noah. He goes on and explains that. In verse 40, he says this: then there will be two men in the field. One will be taken and one will be left. Two women will be grinding at the mill, and one will be taken and one will be left. This is a reference here to a future judgment. As Jesus said, when we get all the fish to the shore and we pull the nets in, the bad fish are going to be thrown away, but they're not just discarded and they're not just thrown into the water again. They're actually going to go through this torment. What Jesus is saying here in Matthew chapter 24 is that there are those who are going to be taken and there are some who will be left. And it's my understanding that you want to be left at that point because you want to go into the millennial kingdom where Jesus is ruling and reigning. Kind of the opposite of the rapture of the church, going into the kingdom. His principle is very clear. There is coming a day of judgment. There's coming a day of reckoning. And Jesus is making it clear that there is a punishment that awaits those who are not people of faith in Christ. In fact, the severity of the punishment will have some measure connected to the revelation that you received. Hebrews chapter 10 says, how much severer punishment do you think he will deserve who has trampled underfoot the Son of God and has regarded as unclean the blood of the covenant by which he was sanctified and has insulted the Spirit of grace? Wow. My friends, the reality is that God is going to make a judgment. Now, when you are separating fish, you would look at the fish and you would determine which fish were good and which fish were bad based upon your understanding of how they taste. You remember that Charlie the Tuna thing? You know, they taste good, right? And so you were kept and eaten. That's a great reward. And some, the bad fish would be cast out. As Jesus makes this, what is the criteria for determining whether the individual, a human being, will spend eternity in heaven or eternity in hell? It doesn't line up exactly with, obviously, the illustration of the dragnet. What it comes down to is whether or not a person has placed their faith in Jesus Christ. Because Jesus Christ came to this world, hung on the cross, and took upon himself our penalty, our sin. And he does that because he is driven by obedience to the Father and a love for you and I. Isn't that amazing? He loves us. Even while we were yet sinners, Christ died for us. Now that is a tremendous, tremendous blessing. You have a decision to make whether you will place your faith and trust in Jesus Christ or you will seek to strive to get into the kingdom of heaven another way. Now, Jesus was very, very clear when he said, I am the way, the truth, and the life. No man can come unto the Father except it be through me. There is only one way to gain entrance into the kingdom of heaven, and that, my friends, is through Jesus Christ. The penalty for not being a person of faith is enormous. Because we are not talking about annihilation, we're not talking about soul sleep, we are not talking about something that is temporary. You hear all of these different teachings today. And even among some evangelicals, there is coming out some strange teaching on whether or not hell is literal. Some people say, well, hell isn't literal. It's really just, your condition. You're going through a rough time in this life, and that's hell for you. Again, we live in a time where there's a moral relativism and there's no absolute truth. And so hell can be whatever you want it to be. And Jesus can die and he can save you from whatever that hell is. And so we find that there's all types of misunderstandings out there. One blogger who's evidently got himself a pretty good audience, he has an issue with the scriptures to start with because he has a lifestyle that is sinful and he seeks to alleviate judgment. And so he writes to great lengths and tries to twist the scriptures to cause the scriptures to say that there is no literal hell. He says that Christians made it up. Now, I don't know about you, but all I need to do is read the scriptures to understand that Jesus spoke a great deal about hell, did he not? It wasn't Christians who made it up. But my friends, hell, according to the scriptures, is literal. Al Mohler does a great job in responding, and he actually writes, he's the president at Southern Seminary, he writes about the reality of hell. And he says that many people don't like to deal with hell as a reality today. And when he says many people, there's an understanding that Protestant mainline churches, the Roman Catholic Church, for instance, you will not hear messages dealing with hell from those pulpits. The only place that you really will hear a message dealing with hell anymore is in the evangelical churches, and they're farther and farther, few in between, that are actually embracing this. And here's the reason why. The reason is because of a doctrine or a study. It's called theodicy. It's the study of evil. And the idea is that people today have resisted God as he's described in the scriptures because we tend to make God the author of all types of things that have happened in our culture that are bad. When Katrina hit, 2005, people asked the question, where was God? When Sandy hit New Jersey, where was God? When something terrible happens in our country and people are killed, where is God? And so in the mindset of many people, there's a desire through apologetics to not create a God who is a God of wrath. And I would submit to you that we don't need to create God at all. God is revealed in his word. We need to take him for as he is revealed in his word, for that is truly who he is. You see, this has become a huge marketing scheme. And there are many who are trying to market God so that people will come and place their faith in Jesus. And so there's a desire to downplay the aspect of the wrath of God. Downplay the fact that there is eternal damnation that awaits those without Christ. We've got to make God more acceptable to the masses, you see. You see, on his own, he's not doing a very good job. You see, people are making too many accusations, and so I'm going to come along with my audacious pride and somehow suggest that I can market God. I can't do that. The reality is God is all-loving, amen? Amen. He is all-loving. He is the epitome of love. Some would say that that is his greatest attribute, but I would say that God is also holy, and I don't understand how all these things fit together, but I know from the scriptures who God has described himself to be. And what Jesus begins to teach is that there is a penalty for not having faith in Christ. And this penalty is very real. And it's so significant that you and I need to be somewhat consumed by its reality. John chapter 3, and I put up there the King James Version, the verse that I memorized as a kid. He that believeth on him is not condemned, but he that believeth not is condemned already. He's already condemned. The reality is that you and I, at the moment of conception, are condemned in our sin nature. We have received our sin nature at that very moment. That's when we began our life. And with that, we have the imputed sin nature going all the way back to Adam that has come into my life. And so because of my sin nature, Jesus is absolutely correct when he says, listen, the problem with the world is that they are condemned already. I didn't need to come into the world to condemn. They're already condemned. And so we turn to the reality of hell. We seek to understand it. Take your Bible and go back with me to Matthew chapter 8. In Matthew chapter 8, we read some things about hell. We read that in Matthew chapter 8, Jesus healed an individual, and he makes it very clear. This is when he deals with the centurion. And Jesus says that he was marveling at the faith. And he says, truly I say to you, I have not found such great faith with anyone in Israel. I say to you that many will come from the east, west, and recline at the table with Abraham, Isaac, and Jacob in the kingdom of heaven. But the sons of the kingdom, sons of the kingdom are those who are Jewish in origin, he says. These will be cast out into outer darkness. In that place there will be weeping and gnashing of teeth. Some have even said that this is not really a literal reference to hell because they're in outer darkness. They've been invited to a feast of sorts, the wedding feast, and they're there, they're in heaven, but they're just in outer darkness. And I can't see that in any way, shape, or form because it goes on to describe the fact that there's weeping and gnashing of teeth. And my friends, it's my understanding that when you get to heaven, there is absolutely no weeping or gnashing of teeth. There is joy and there is praise and there is the miracle of living in an environment where there is no sin. But note what the scriptures say. As Jesus teaches about hell, he teaches that it is a place of outer darkness. If you've ever shared your faith, you probably have come across someone who says, listen, thanks a lot, but I'm not interested in heaven. I'm going to hang out with my friends in hell. I'm going to hang out with my friends. It'll be a great experience. Now, I don't know about you, but I don't see so well in the dark. And I heard God does not allow night vision into hell. If you end up spending your eternity in hell, there will be nothing that you see. Because the absence of light is one of the primary adjectives here of this place. Hell, there will be no light. God is not present there. There is no sun. It is absolutely pitch dark. You will not be able to see. I don't know about you, but I don't have a lot of fun with people when I can't see anything. This is not a good scenario. It's also described in Matthew chapter 25 in verse 41 is a place of fire. And God uses the word fire to describe hell's torment, but it's not a usual fire, for there's no relief from this suffering. Most fires, we try to feed them to keep them going, don't we? But these fires will never go out. This is a place as well of great pain. In Matthew 8 that we just soon read here, the sons of the kingdom cast into outer darkness, and accompanied with that is the weeping and the gnashing of teeth. Can you imagine for all of eternity, this is what you're going to hear, this weeping, as it's a place of torment and pain. I have never had any enjoyment when I have been in pain. And you have neither. When you're in the hospital and you're experiencing pain and someone comes to visit you, you appreciate it, but do you have a good time with them? If you have the flu, do you call your friends to come over and watch TV with you? You see, this is a place of such torment that this is a horrible experience. And Mark chapter 9 and verse 44 and 46, it describes hell as a place where the worm doesn't die. You know, when Jesus was talking about the worm dieth not, he was quoting a passage from Isaiah 66. And the relative reality of that worm that dies not, if your body dies, or when your body dies, and you're with the Lord, the worms will eat my body when it's dead. And eventually it'll run out and they'll go find somebody else. Say, that's disgusting. Yeah. But bon appetit, you can have it. I'm getting a new body. Amen? Whoo! There's not going to be a worm within a mile. I'll tell you that. Jesus says this is a place where the worm never dies because the person never dies. This is a place of eternal judgment. You and I cannot comprehend eternity in our finite minds. I don't care if you're talking about heaven or hell. You and I can't wrap our minds around eternity. Eternity is, Pastor Kevin has one more minute before he's got to be done. It seems like eternity, but it's not eternity. You and I cannot comprehend eternity. Eternity on and on and on. And I think of heaven, and I think of the awe of heaven, and I'm just amazed at the significance of heaven. But I'm also burdened about eternity in hell. Who would want anyone to spend eternity in hell? When Jesus was teaching in Mark chapter 9, he talked about the significance of avoiding hell. He said, if your hand offends you, you should do what? Cut it off. Now, we remember that part of his teaching, but oftentimes we don't remember what follows that. But he says that it would be better to have your hand cut off than to risk eternity in hell. In other words, what Jesus was saying was, by all means, you have to do whatever is in your power to come and avoid hell. And then he's going to give them the answer to how to do that. And that answer is he himself being the Savior of the world. Well, you and I understand the significance of hell. When we can understand the significance of hell, we will understand the significance of salvation. John 3:18 says that we're condemned already, but Romans chapter 8 says, therefore there is now how much condemnation? There is no condemnation to those who are in Christ Jesus. And I would submit to you that you and I, who are people of faith, should be desiring with all that is in us to see that every single person in this world is in Christ Jesus. We don't want one single person. Jesus said, I come to seek and to save that which is lost. That's what Jesus' motivation is. He does not want one of these people that he's dealing with, including the Pharisees, including the Sadducees, including the rotten to the core. My friends, we're all rotten to the core. We've all needed deliverance. We've all needed Jesus Christ. How horrifying it is to think that there will be people that we've come in contact with in our lives that we have failed to share Jesus Christ with because we haven't been burdened as we should be burdened. This past January at a pastor's conference, I heard an 80-some-year-old preacher preach a message. And he preached this message. And we've heard him for, I've heard him, I think, 8 years now preach. And he can, when you're 80 some years old, you can say whatever you want to say when you're preaching. Do you know that? They help him up to the pulpit. He hangs his cane on the side of it. There he is, Junior Hill. He's been in evangelism for 1,000 years. This was the best message that I'd ever heard him preach. And he got to this little segment, and the conviction was enormous. My friends, listen, hell is real. There'll be some invitations you can pick up as you leave the auditorium this morning, and hopefully you'll give those to someone that you know that you want to come and hear the gospel of Jesus Christ. But I want you to hear this testimony by Junior Hill. It's about 6 minutes long, so bear with it. And I apologize, I don't have a DVD, but I think you'll get the message.
Not only are we distracted by what we see, but we're disqualified by how we feel. Did you notice what the psalmist said? He that goeth forth and weepeth, bearing precious seed. God simply says that if you're going to sow seeds, you have to have a broken heart or spirit for those seed that you're sowing. And dear friend, I want to tell you today, and I'm sad to say this, but what's happened to the church today is that old-time brokenness and crying over lost sinners has virtually disappeared. How long has it been since you've been in a church where you saw men and women fall down upon their faces and cry out to God to save lost sinners that were around them? You don't see that in the average church today. If they cry at all, it's about something else. I was in a meeting not long ago, and I preached on Saturday night, and it was as dead as a doornail. Nobody responded. I don't think I'd have responded myself after listening to that sermon. It was terrible. I was standing down at the front, kind of discouraged that nobody had responded, and this guy walked up to me, took my hand. He was crying, just big tears rolling down his face. He said, "Brother Junior, we lost, did we?" And I thought in my heart, hallelujah to God, this man has a burden for souls, and he knows we lost the battle tonight. But it occurred to me that I might ought to ask him what he meant, and I said, "What do you mean we lost?" He said, "Tennessee got beat today." And I said, "Lord God, have mercy upon us. We're weeping, but we're weeping for the wrong thing. Brokenness has been replaced by brashness. And we got a generation of men and women who don't know how to weep. And rather than fall upon our faces and weep over that which we cannot do anything about but claim God, we find it easier just to change gears. And so we just call the latest gurus on church growth that'll tell us how to grow a church without preaching gospel sermons. And now we can do it without being broken or concerned because men won't listen to this present gospel in which we live. Oh, may God have mercy upon us and give us hearts ablaze for God so we could go out and try to win somebody to Jesus, ladies and gentlemen. We need some weeping over those that are lost." I sometimes am amazed at how little I care about the souls of men, and I'm an evangelist traveling around the country. I wonder sometimes how in the world could I be so careless. I went to buy my wife a car not so long ago, and I live in a little town of probably about 12,000-15,000. Most everybody knows one another. And so I went to this car place, and a guy came out and welcomed me, and I said, "Sir, I'd like to buy a car for my wife." And he said, "Well, sure, come on, I'll show you some." While I was walking out to the lot, he turned to me and he said, "You're Brother Hill, aren't you? Aren't you a preacher?" I said, "Well, yes, sir, I am a preacher." Now, I'm going to be honest with you, and I'm ashamed to say this, but I wasn't interested in talking about preaching. I was there to buy a car. And so I said, yes, sir, I'm a preacher. And while I was walking out there, and I looked at the car and started to go back to do some settlement about buying the car, he said, "Brother Hill, somebody told me that you'd written some books about Christian principles." I said, "Well, yes, sir, I have. I've written some books." He said, "You know, I sure would like to have some of those books. I'm going through a real deep time in my life. I've got a lot of problems. You reckon you could get me some of those books? Well, yes, sir, I will. I'll try to get them for you. I left that car lot, and it never crossed my mind again. It was as if I never met that man. I came back a couple of weeks later to have some little adjustments done on the automobile. And he saw me. And he came running out across the car lot. "Brother Junior, so glad to see you. I haven't got those books yet. Sir, I'm sorry. Please forgive me. I'll get those books for you. Car needs some adjustments." And I was on my way. I came home about 3 weeks later. And my sweet wife had cut out a little clipping out of the newspaper. She didn't say a word. She just laid it on my desk. Here's what it said. "Local car salesman shoots himself to death." And I looked at that. And I heard a lonely man who'd crossed my path. And I didn't care. I'm an evangelist. I'm writing books. I'm preaching sermons. I'm speaking at conferences. But two backslidden to help a lonely man.
Would you stand with me, please? Are we too busy to help the lost, to give them the good news that Jesus Christ died for their sin? We're going to have a word of prayer. If you're here today and you're not certain of where you'll spend your eternity, there will be personal workers here at the front that would love to talk to you. Maybe you came with someone today and maybe you want to talk to them. I encourage you to take the step. Place your faith in Jesus Christ that you might know that you have eternal life. If you're here this morning and God's pricking your heart to be more aware of the lost, I trust that this coming week, we'll have the opportunity to look beyond ourselves and to look towards those who need to hear the gospel. Pick up an invitation card as you're walking out. And may God bless it. And may next week, when we come to worship, may there be a harvest, people who have placed their faith in Christ. God, we give you thanks for this day. The testimony of Scripture is clear. Help us, Father, to have your heart. Help us, Father, not to be backslidden. But, Father, help us to be as concerned about others as you are. That we would not use our days to consume them upon ourselves, but that we might do your work. Bring about a harvest, I pray, Lord. Bring about laborers to the harvest field. I pray this all in Christ's name. Amen. Hope to see you Friday.